Thank you all for coming out here today. We are here to talk about the revisions we made to our budget since we put out our House and Senate Republican budget 2 weeks ago. As you know, since then there has been a $1.5 billion addition to the deficit, which puts us over $5 billion in deficit. It has not been easy for any of us to put this together, but we feel it's our responsibility to come up with an alternative, particularly going into tomorrow's first day of negotiations with the governor and all the leaders. We believe very strongly that the most important part of this budget is to make sure we come out with no tax increases, because the state of Connecticut has been burdened enough with tax increase after tax increase after tax increase. As you know, we've had the two highest in the past 6 years. We want to make sure that in addition to no tax increases, we are controlling our borrowing, which we have put a cap of $1.2 billion. We have a spending cap, which is the most strict of all the options on the table, as you saw in the summer with the spending cap commission. We are under that cap, and we wanted to make sure that the people that need our help, like the hospitals, are helped, but also cities and towns are not left high and dry in midstream, and to add to that, not only midstream, but the last month of our fiscal year with the governor's cutting of Pequot.
It's obvious that the Republicans are looking, the Democrats are looking for some big revenue. Casino, tolls, marijuana, you're not going that way. Where's your revenue?
Well, do you want
to? So earlier, Representative Clarides mentioned the bond cap. It's $1.3 billion. We see significant savings in debt service when we lower that bond cap, about $63 million. And Chris, I would turn it over to you for other of the revenue changes.
Listen, not only do we recommend not doing new revenue streams, we're also recommending sunsetting the corporate tax surcharge, recommending removing income taxes on Social Security, similar to what the Democrats did as well. And we're also recommending not moving forward with the governor's proposal for $20 million in fee increases that we don't know where those fee increases come from. So there's various different places in the state budget that we're looking to find savings to help offset some of those revenue increases that the Democratic Party and the governor have proposed, and we stand ready to negotiate with them moving forward about those spending changes.
What gets cut?
So one of the main things that we do differently than we did 2 weeks ago is that we decided that we should not at this time go forward with a new ECS formula. So that ECS formula 2 weeks ago had an additional spending of $67 million in each year for 10 years. We've decided as a caucus that we really need to focus on our problems for the next 2 years and spend the time this summer working with stakeholders, superintendents, the teachers union to develop an ECS formula. So that was one way. We also eliminate MRSA, which the governor did as well the last couple of days. Yes.
We've also eliminated, as the governor did, the gap accounting, which was, I think, $57 million.
Right.
And the reason we did that was, even though it's something we support in theory, there will end up being, based on all the budget problems we have, a rebasing of our budget to start. So then gap should be reassessed and looked at after that. But right now, as much as we want, as Representative Jebra mentioned, to do a new ECS formula, this has been a long time coming. And to put together a formula in a couple months, I don't think is necessarily a responsible way. I give credit to everyone who has come up with one, and I like the one that we had put in our original budget. But right now, with a $3 billion deficit, then an additional deficit in the past 2 weeks, we have to batten down the hatches and figure out what needs to be taken care of right now, and then make those structural changes to make sure this doesn't continue down this road.
Are you seeking additional labor concessions beyond the $700 million next fiscal year?
Yes. We produced a list that creates parity with the private sector as far as, for instance, healthcare, office co-pays. We also believe it's important for our friends in the state unions to pay the national average towards their state employee retirement system. So we count on a 6% contribution level, which is the national average for that as well. So that's an additional place. We also believe that the $300 million for the reserve or salary account should be eliminated.
Chris, could you talk about the changes to the EITC? Because you basically eliminate most of it. Most working poor families would be ineligible. It was always kind of controversial because it was a refundable credit. Could you talk about that decision?
So our EITC proposal is to make it so that it's non-refundable. So essentially the EITC program would still exist. It would only cover up to your tax liability. So it would no longer be above and beyond what you would otherwise pay in taxes. So some have argued that this program goes well beyond any kind of tax credit program and instead is something that is closer to cash payment to these individuals. So we're trying to move in a direction that makes it more more towards a tax credit, which would cover their tax liability.
And forward. Keith, you know, I've heard other Republicans mention, you know, Ronald Reagan did it, and we're big fans of him, so why are we, do we have a problem with it? We don't have a problem with it per se, but to Chris's point, this started out as a tax credit, and it ended up being much more, and I don't think those consequences were intended. So I think that we have to get rid of certain things that aren't working right now, and in that vein, to help the people that are going to lose some of that, we put back and restored the property tax credit for everyone up to current levels of $200, because we really believe that that is what your middle class person gets the most bang for the buck.
And so what is the bottom line on the labor savings that you guys assume then?
It's about $725 million in each year, plus we eliminated the RSA account.
So an extra $25 million over, or is that $725?
Yes, that's a $25 million over the $700. But in addition to that, we eliminated the RSA account, which was $300 million.
What about tolls?
Reserve for salary account.
Okay.
What about
tolls? It's an OPM's budget.
We do not include tolls in our budget proposal.
Any casino expansion either?
We do not include new revenues from casino expansion as well.
Do you guys still have the passport for parks in years?
Yes, we do.
Back to the 200 on, did you change your proposal? In other words, didn't you do it only for dependents and the elderly? Are you saying you're not doing that now?
Yeah, this is an updated proposal. We had to make a lot of significant cuts. Chris just mentioned one, the EITC. So in looking at the overall proposal, we felt, you know, we went through it line by line and updated our budget line by line. And we look forward to other ideas as well.
And Chris,
are we back to the full $200
credit? We're back to the full $200 for everyone. And the reason we did that was because we understood that moving out of the EITC may be problematic for certain people, but it's our understanding that 93% of the people who avail themselves of the EITC get actual money back as opposed to the tax credit, as we talked about earlier, which was the intention of the program. So for the people that were losing it, we felt it was important to restore the full $200 tax credit for everyone.
Melissa, is marijuana part of this thing?
No, it's not part of the Republican budget. You know, Themis and I disagree on the legalization of marijuana, but I believe very strongly that it should be legalized. But that process should go through this chamber and be fully debated by the legislature, not just stuck in the budget as an opportunity to find more reasons not to make the hard decisions and cut spending. I do believe in it, but I think it should be fully debated by the legislature.
You guys roll back any tax, sales tax exemptions or other tax breaks?
There's two that you might look at as a tax fairness issue. We're removing the exemptions on some of the admissions taxes on the Yard Goats games, the XL Center, Webster Bank, and that's more of a tax fairness. If other facilities are being taxed, why aren't these other facilities being taxed? The other one would be a single provider out in Eastern Connecticut for an energy provider that gets a $3.7 million a year tax break from the state of Connecticut, something that only affects them and provided to them and not to everybody else. So that's one of the tax exemptions that we're looking to roll back as well.
Who's that to? Is that Dominion or is that to like the
no,
chicken?
It's a steam generator
steam,
out.
Steam, right. Turbine generator out in Eastern Connecticut.
Did you say chicken?
As someone from Eastern Connecticut, I take offense.
The other,
you never know. You never know.
Chicken farmers.
You never know. It's okay.
We love chicken farmers in Eastern Connecticut. So one of the other important issues that we do is a policy change. Is we believe strongly that one-time revenue should be immediately deposited into the rainy day fund. So we took the $14 million that was being counted on. And instead of depositing it to the general fund, we do a direct deposit to the rainy day fund. So we don't count that in our balance.
And as far as policies...
No, that's the Volkswagen settlement for $14 million.
And on that subject of policies, we think that going forward, instead of having towns and cities rely so strongly on us when they don't want to, okay, when a lot of them don't want to. We're like a hamster in a cage every year because they want our budgets to be done sooner. We want our budgets to be done sooner, but that hasn't happened thus far. Give them independence. Allow them to make decisions for themselves, because most towns and cities do it much better than we do it as state government. Allow them to share services amongst, for example, their boards of ed and their towns. Allow them, you know, the freedom of binding arbitration. Things that, besides the unfunded mandates they're drowning in that you hear us yell about every year, all day long, give them freedom to make decisions on their own so they're not relying on us as much, and then we don't end up in this struggle every year of how much are they getting, how much are they not getting, where are they getting cut.
What about local option tax?
Should towns and cities be able to impose a 1% sales tax? Should towns and cities be able to tax nonprofit hospitals' property? Should they be able to charge?
We don't have any of those policies in our document. There's none of those policies are included in this document. I mean, obviously, Representative Clarendon and other leaders and the governor will sit down tomorrow, and I'm hopeful that this document can provide a real framework to hold the line and draw a line in the sand and create an opportunity for people to stay in the state.
What do you think? You're not proposing any tax increases. They say they're not proposing any direct tax increases. Do you think the budget that eventually gets passed is going to contain some sort of tax increases?
Well, I would hope not, because that is not something that my caucus is interested in. I am open to walking in that room, and I walk in believing that everybody put forth an idea in good faith. But I'll tell you one thing I have a problem with. I have a real problem with the fact that although we are in the minority by a small amount and the Senate is tied, the Senate Democrats and the House Democrats have still not given anybody a full-fledged line-by-line budget. So we didn't do that a couple weeks ago. We have. Now, the Senate and the House Republicans, we've come up with our own ideas, and we believe that the more ideas, the better for the process going forward tomorrow. But I know that you still don't have their line-by-line budget. And since when, I'm honored, okay, and I'm flattered by the fact everybody wants to know where the Republicans' budgets are, because we have taken this responsibility very seriously. But what about them? Like, it's okay that they just are not interested in doing it anymore, and they'll just wait till tomorrow? I mean, you want to talk about a lack of leadership? That's what we've seen in this
building. So how do you feel going into talks tomorrow? Do you feel like everybody's got their cards on the table?
Well, I would hope they do, and that's the assumption I'm going to work on walking into the room.
Optimistic that you will be probably more involved in this budget negotiation than previous ones.
I am optimistic until I'm not.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.